Yeah, it's really, to me, it's very wonderful to just to share a story or two. You know, I had a very good job. So I got a degree in those days, years ago. I came out of school. It's not like the United States. I did a degree in timber technology and economics simultaneously with doing an apprenticeship in a business, a big timber company. I won't go into those details so much, but I did very well. I really enjoyed my work tremendously. And during that time, God moved on me and changed me, and I was filled with the Holy Ghost and the little churches began in our area. So I was sort of 20, 21 already. Little churches were coming into being. It's a wonderful time. And I worked, loved my work. And at the age of 21, I had 22, I had 300 or 400 men under me and millions of pounds worth of equipment. I so loved it. And then I was just involved with these little churches, and life was very, very full. And then the Lord spoke to me amazingly. I should say that during this time, I was very well paid. And as God was getting hold of my heart in those years, I just began to give, and I supported missions. And so much so that I reached the point where I was easily giving away half of my income, and sometimes more. And so no savings. And didn't worry me. I was single. I didn't have a girlfriend or anyone to worry about. I was just giving a little money to my parents for my keep in the house. So my expenses were few. I always drove secondhand cars, and seemed the wise thing to do. And so there it was. And then out of the blue, the Lord spoke to my heart, "I want you to leave work. I want you to go to the Bible seminary." And it was clear, absolutely clear. It was just unmistakable. And my work was, I necessitated giving 3 months, that I was going to leave. So to give them an opportunity. And I applied to the college and was accepted. But within 2 weeks of handing in my notice, 3 months ahead I was going to leave, I had a letter from West Virginia, of all places, out of the blue. And they had heard of me, that I knew how to operate certain facilities that were a new development in the timber trade, and they didn't have any operators. They'd set up these facilities in their timber yard in West Virginia, and they offered me a job and house supplied and car supplied. What a thing. And I knew it was the devil. I knew it was the devil. Anyway, I talked to my father about this, that I wasn't going to take this job, that I was going to carry on. And he swore at me and called me a number of names, that I was an absolute fool. You can serve God without all this, getting so serious about it. And then, no, Dad, I've got to do it. I've got to do it. And then I went along to my old Italian grandfather. In fact, up in this, right on this wall here, I have a collage, I suppose you'd call them, of photographs of my Italian family. And my old grandfather's there, and he was a godly old man. He'd become a godly old man. And I went to him and I said, "Granddad, I'm leaving my job in 3 months' time, and I'm going to serve the Lord and go to college." And my old granddad sort of began to get teary, began to weep a little bit, and he got up and he struggled across to this chest of drawers in the room, and he opened up a drawer and he grasped a wadge of money like this, rolls of notes. He said, "I have been saving this for many years for my pension to give to you when you would move out and serve the Lord." And I didn't have any money for the college fees. And what my grandfather gave me covered the first period, what do you call it? And just the kindness of the Lord, and just his love and his care. And I just want to encourage us with that. Was a wonderful lesson for little Bernard, launching out on something new. And I thought, well, Lord, I've got my car. I had an MG car, if you know what an MG is, sports car, second hand. And I thought, well, Lord, I'm going to need money for the second term period in the college, so I can always sell the car. And as I was driving up, the car broke down terminally. That was that gone. Hallelujah. And so the sweet lessons of the Lord begin to come. And you've got stories, I'm sure, where you've seen the Lord do things like that. He careth for you. He careth for you. And we can encourage one another with our stories, We really can. And to learn to live in the flesh, we do not have to do, but you do have to learn to live in the spirit. We don't have to learn to live in the flesh. The scripture talks, doesn't it, in a number of places. It's Paul mainly, in the Galatian letter, in the Roman letter. He contrasts flesh and spirit. And, I want to make a comment or two just for a little while about flesh and spirit, partly arising out of last week when we were all together and discussing a little bit about old man and new man and holiness and having a pure heart and so on. When you come into Romans, and I'm in the Roman letter, and I'm in chapter 7, and which follows on 6. And you know how in chapter 7, verse 5, there is a very clear statement. While we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions, aroused by the law, were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we are discharged from the law, dead to that which held us captive, so that we serve not under the old written code, but in the new life of the Spirit. So Paul is contrasting what we were, where we used to live. We used to live in the flesh. When we were living in the flesh, that was the fountainhead of our life, the fountainhead provoked our sinful passions. My version says they were aroused by the law, the written code. Do this, don't do that. Do this, don't do that. Live by the written law, the code, the code, the code. That's what happened. The law came. And Paul says similar things in the Galatian letter. He tells us that the law had no power to change. But, it stirs up the sinful patterns. I ought not to do this. I ought not to do that. But now we serve not under the written code, but in the new life of the Spirit, verse 6. And this little section in Romans 7 is very wonderful. Richard and I were talking about it the other day, a little bit, where he's, let's just read it down, these first four verses. Do you not know, brethren? For I'm speaking to those who know the law, that the law is only binding on a person during his life. Thus, a married woman is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lives. But if her husband dies, she is discharged from the law concerning the husband. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lives with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law. And if she marries another man, she is not an adulteress. Likewise, my brethren, you have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit for God. They're lovely verses, really. How much do we really believe them? You know, that we in Christ were married to Christ. You know, in Christ we died to our old marriage, died to the law, died to the do's and don'ts. Christ is who himself fulfilled the law, so that he who lives in the Spirit will most certainly fulfill the law. He who lives in Christ will most certainly fulfill the moral law. He who lives in the Spirit, from Christ, from the fountainhead that Christ is, he who lives from Christ, in the Spirit, will most certainly fulfill automatically the law. And the law is simplified down into two, isn't it? Simplified down into two. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, with all thy strength. And the second is like unto it. He shall love his neighbor as himself. The law of love, the royal law. And so the person we are freed from being married to the do's and the don'ts. We are joined to Christ. This is what Paul's theology is. This is his doctrine. You're not under the law of rights and wrongs and do's and don'ts. You are under law to Christ, or under law to Christ. Isn't that an amazing thing? And you're in Christ, you're in the Spirit. And I just want you to go down this section afterwards. So from verse 7, I want you to, can you scan down 7 right the way down to verse 24? And can you tell me the recurring word and the absent words, so that there's several. I'll help a bit. What then shall we say, verse 7, that the law is sin? Definitely not. Yet if it had not been for the law, I should not have known sin. I should not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, finding opportunity in the commandment, wrought in me all kinds of covetousness. I suddenly awoke. The law woke me up to what was in me. So he goes on down and he says, sin. And he says, apart from the law, sin lies dead. And but then I just want you to notice the repeated word, I, me, I, me. Me, death to me, verse 13. goes on, I, verse 14, am carnal, sold under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. I, me, my flesh, me, my. I goes on and on and on and on. Not one mention of the Spirit, not one mention of Jesus Christ. It's all law exposing what I am, making me aware of my paucity. I want to throw something out to you, just in passing, not to complicate things, but just, is it spiritual law that you never get the good of Christ until you come to the bottom of yourself? You never come to the riches that are in Christ until you come to the end of yourself, your pride, whatever it is. Is that true? Is that a spiritual law? No. To the end of myself, nothing. And in little doses, I've had this in little doses all the way through my life. Bernard, you've got nothing. You are nothing. And led there by the Spirit to that deep conviction of yourself, that apart from me, you can do nothing. That's what the Lord sort of says to us. You know, and let me throw this out to you. Do you believe that Christ, Jesus, is going to be revealed to the Jew? At the end of the age, do you believe that? I believe that it is very likely that there will be a time when they will look upon him whom they have pierced with the eyes of faith first, and there will be a great move. And many shall turn unto the Lord. There are actually already, I was talking to another brother from overseas who's, you know, has many friends in Tel Aviv and other parts. And we were discussing this together. I'm quite sure that God is going to, and he was agreeing. He said, that's what I believe. That's what I believe. I'm sure. And I said to him, who's among the most proud races in the world? Who, above all proportion to their population, have had more geniuses, scientists, brilliant experts, than above all other nations? And he said, Israel. I said, yes, that's right, brother. Above all the proportions of their numbers, you know, they've been brilliant. Brilliant in business, brilliant in science, brilliant in all these things. And is it not this brilliance that has kept them going to this time? Is it not this brilliance? Could it be that there's going to be a time when they shall come to an end of themselves, and they will look upon when perhaps nations will be gathered around them, and all kinds of things will happen, and they will come to the end of all of their flesh. And they will look upon their Saviour. And I said this to him, and he said to me, "It is remarkable, Bernard, that it's already beginning to happen." He said to me, "Some of my friends who minister among them are finding that they are wanting to read the New Testament about Jesus. It's never happened before in his ministry among them." And he said, "Something is happening, something, as they have are looking upon the rage in the nation, or a certain part of the nation." But the point that I'm really making, the end of the flesh, the end of the flesh, till you come to this incredible explosion of an utterance, verse 24, "Wretched man that I am." Oh, wretched man. This isn't self-pity. This isn't, this is the convicting, convincing of the law that's done its work, that's brought a person to the place of no confidence in the flesh. "Wretched man that I am, who," I hope you get this, "who will deliver me?" At last, we're beyond all the kind of doing this, doing that, and doing the other. I need a savior. Who shall deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. It's Jesus. And how does he do it? "So then, I of myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh, I've come to an understanding that something's got to go on in me, that by a great savior, someone of power." And then he comes to it, doesn't he? "Through Jesus Christ our Lord, there is no condemnation. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law," so he's back to what he was talking about at the beginning of chapter 7, "the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin, death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemns sin in the flesh. In order that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit." Isn't that a lovely verse? That the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. The law of the Spirit of the life in Christ Jesus. The great question of my life, as things come that tempt, from what source will I live? Will I live from my flesh, from the flesh, or will I live from the source of the spirit? When you flesh and spirit, they are sources from which people live. Fountainheads from which people live. Will I live? Because there is no law that makes me sin. There is now a law in me, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, that would energize me to obey, to love the Lord, to walk in obedience to him. There's a law. There is no law in me. He's made me free from the law of sin and death. I am not under obligation to continue in sin. The law of the life in Christ Jesus. That doesn't mean to say that we cannot sin, that sin is now beyond us, but there is this great law working in us. I praise God for this. I praise God. I praise God for the revelation of it as it came to me years and years ago. It put me on the victory side. It put me on the victory side. It transferred me from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the Son of his love. It transferred me from the inevitability of falling, of collapsing, of giving way when the tempter comes. There is a law that drives me on. A law that drives you on, the law of the spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus. It makes you free from the law of sin and death. It keeps you free. It enables you to maintain a holiness of walk, a God-pleasing walk. This is the law of the spirit of his life. Blessed be his name. And this is why when you get to the lovely eighth chapter, it's not so much about I and me and I and me. You go through the chapter, I and me is almost absent. It's him and spirit. You know, it's him and spirit, it's him. Amen. You're not in the flesh, verse 9. You are in the spirit. In fact, if in fact the spirit of God dwells in you, you're on the victory side. And the great question for you and me is, when did you receive the Holy Ghost? And the second question in your life and my life is, are you living from the fountainhead of the Spirit today? Will you live from the Spirit? Will you do it? You're not in the flesh. There's been this incredible change. You can understand why, dear Paul, He's going to tell us quite a lot about the blessed ministry of the Spirit in us, right the way through this chapter. This, he says, the Spirit that dwells in you. And he says, the Spirit, your spirits are alive. Glory to God. I do wish, my brethren, that... you know, we would get the center right. Tomorrow morning, I've got to speak. It's tomorrow evening for the Malaysian people. Bibi always wants these titles beforehand. And so you can think of me. So I'll have a Zoom meeting at noon, 8 o'clock in the evening for them in Malaysia. And a few from Canada come on, and one or two from the States. She always wants a title. Oh, titles, Bibi, titles. Titles are difficult for me, And, so I sent her this title, the true center dash beyond illusion and delusion. I'll say it again. The true center dash beyond illusion and delusion. The devil is the great delusionist or illusionist. He will keep us from the truth that Christ is in us, the hope of glory. Christ is in us as a church, as a group of brethren. Think of that thought about the coming together in a conference time for just 5 days. The hope of glory. Christ is in us, the hope of glory. He's the hope of me becoming a glorious man. Don't you want to be a glorious man? I want to be a, I'm not talking about some handsome devil who's, got perpetual youth or something like that. Of course I'm not. I'm talking about a man of glory. A man of glory is a tender man, a strong man, a courageous man, a brave man, a loving man. Oh, what a man of glory. So wonderful when you start going down this eighth chapter, he says you'll all be led by the Spirit of God. I really enjoy it. In verse 14 talks about the where will you be led to? Where will you, the Spirit lead you? So let's read it, verse 12. So then, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh, but to live according to the flesh. Amen. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all, notice the for all. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Amen. If by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, isn't that great? That's what he'll lead you to do. He'll lead you to put to death the deeds of the body. That's what he'll lead you to do. That's what he'll empower you to do. Amen. Do you find this? Did you used to look at things years ago that you shouldn't really have looked at? And you don't do it now? Because the Spirit of the Lord has been lusting in you and leading you to turn away. He's the living one. Did you used to defend yourself? Were you a man who always needed to have the last word in an argument? And now it's not that you don't bother, he's led you away from keeping your end up and winning the argument. Am I making sense? As I say, this is what the Spirit leads us to. You put to death the deeds of the body, you know, that wants to be right and wants to win the argument. And the Spirit of the Lord leads you away from it. Going back to my college days, goodness me, the arguments that went on, the perennial arguments, men almost coming to punches over Calvinism and Arminianism and all about, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. And of course, I got involved at one time when I first was there, and I would swing my doctrinal axe at a few heads and try and chop them off. And then as I waited on God and got centered right, you know, I didn't get involved. The Spirit of the Lord was leading me away from these things. Glory to God. It's great, isn't it? It's great. I love it. I want to turn you know, if you go through the rest of the eighth of Romans, you'll find so much the Spirit leads us into and does into it in us. You know, he leads us, you know, this whole realm of prayer Paul talks about and helps our weakness and, oh, bless the name of the Lord. But go into the Galatians chapters and just let me comment and then I'll stop and we can discuss it a bit, you know. But you know the famous chapter, it's the fifth, isn't it, where Paul is bringing them. And you know, I say, verse 16, walk by the Spirit, and you won't gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to prevent you from doing what you would. But if you are, here's the, again, led by the Spirit, you are not under law. Now, the works of the flesh are plain. Fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, selfishness, dissension, party spirit, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and the like. There's a formidably terrible list there of the works of the flesh. If someone is living from the flesh, now, I'll say something now. You know, they're living from the powers of their own soul. They're giving full vent to the powers of their own soul. They are giving free vent to their minds as their minds imagine horrible things. And as their mind begins to imagine, if they're a younger man, but even if older, their body begins to react to what their mind is dwelling upon. That's just one realm of the sensual that I mentioned. But I've come to the conclusion, my brethren, that a man can minister out of his own mind, and it's really his fleshly pride. minister doctrine, could minister teaching. It will feed his own pride, and it will bring people under the bondage of the letter that kills, and they're under the law. You know, I think this accounts for how some ministries go wrong. You know, where they become very brilliant in certain doctrine teachings, and their mind, and they gradually, as they become famous or get a following, they get into this illusory state where they think they are a great gift. I think some of this accounts in the psychic side of things with some of the great ministries that developed, especially, you know, 70 years ago, a little longer, maybe 75, 80 years ago. Some of these, the spawning of a lot of healing evangelists, and who some of whom went astray with their doctrines, that was their flesh. And then they began to become deluded. The devil began to delude them and began to feed in some errors to them. And so they began to say some weird things that couldn't be founded biblically. It's an amazing thing. Strife and jealousy, all these things. Flesh in the church. Flesh in the church. People living from that fountain of their flesh. If I come back in my mind to Israel, do you think that Netanyahu is a man of the flesh? Challenging to reflect on these things. Verse 22 is the lovely one, isn't it? But the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit. I needn't mention the contrast between works and fruit, need I? I mean, you can think that one through. I'm sure you have done already. Fruit. Fruit. Fruit of a man in a man's life who's living in the sweet fellowship with the Lord Jesus by the Spirit. Fruit. Hardly knows that it's coming forth. I wonder if the tree knows. You know, the tree doesn't work hard to produce the fruit, does it? But works take labor, but fruit just emerges in its time. Fruit of the Spirit is love. Hallelujah. Joy, peace, patience, kindness. Wonderful words, aren't they? Hallelujah. Lord, help us. So I'll stop now. That's enough for me. You know, we can talk about it a little, and just the wonder to me, the lore of his life. The lore of his life has made me free from the lore of sin and death. Oh, hallelujah. What a liberating word that is. The law. I don't have to yield to temptation. I don't have to sin knowingly. I don't have to. I don't. The law of the spirit of his life made me free. I think these things need to be said strongly but tenderly to us men, because we've all known defeat. We've all known defeat. We've sunk into our flesh at times. We thought that we could not overcome. We thought that we were going to live in a ceaseless battle for the rest of our days. I will tell you where the battle is. The battle is in one main place: to tempt a man and a woman away from the simplicity which is in Christ. Listening to one voice, hearing him, the complexity, can you see it in the garden with Adam and Eve? Ah, my brethren, there was but one voice, the voice of God. And they lived under that voice. With that voice, that presence, glorious God, centered. And then another voice, complicating everything, complicating everything. Our life is so complex, so many voices, so much complexity. It's all so complicated. You know, that's where it all is. The simplicity that's in Christ, the law of his life, set me free from the law of sin and death. Glory to God. Let's rejoice in that. Let's believe it. Hallelujah.